important to people in this district before Dan heads off to the session. Just like a few ground rules before, there will be plenty of time for questions, but we just ask that everybody gets a chance to ask one question before you get your second question. You raise your hand when you're asking a question so that this can just flow a little bit more smoothly. Just feel free to ask whatever you want. We're going to start actually with Juana, who helped arrange this whole thing. And she's been an incredible help to us, especially in the principalium part of our district. So she's going to start off and say a few words, and then Dan will tell you a little bit about himself.
Hi, my name is Lana Craven, for those of you who don't know me. I first got involved with the Dan Helmer campaign because I wanted to see change come to Virginia. I moved to Prince William County 3 years ago. I have 3 kids in the school system, and my husband is a Navy reservist who just returned home in June from 400 days deployment. So we have lots of voices that needed to be heard in our house alone, and so I went to Richmond and I spoke with my delegate then, and games were played, lots of obstruction things happened. I'm sure you all know about the special session in July, how it was adjourned quickly. So I needed to work for change, and so I found Dan, and I knew that Dan would represent the constituents, families like myself, and support us in Richmond instead of big business and big donors. So without further ado, the Delegate-Elect, Dan Helmer.
Thank you so much, Lana. Together about what that looks like and how we are a citizen legislature. And it's one of the most exciting things. I run a small business. I'm still in the Army Reserve. My wife's a public school teacher. None of that changes once you get elected, and so I have to come back and be part of the same community that I'm serving down in Richmond. And so that's what makes it so exciting. So I'm mostly here to hear from you about what your concerns are, what you're thinking about. There's going to be lots of things you're thinking about that maybe I haven't had a chance to think about, and always be transparent and tell you that if that's the case, and look forward to this being the start of a dialogue, not a one-off event, and one in which we can continue to think through a long relationship and a process in which governing is not so much about what I do, but what we collectively as a community do together. And so with that, I'd love to turn it over to all of you. Yes, sir.
Dan, the first thing off the top of my head is I see the NRA is already spending money before you guys have even articulated positions, assuming that there's a threat to the Second Amendment. And they're talking about these Second Amendment sanctuaries already. I don't know what that means. I don't think they know what it means, but it sounds good. Can you give us a sense of where you think the legislature is going to go on gun control and just the whole issue around guns and safety in our schools and things like that that we're all concerned about?
Yeah, I mean, the context of this is that where we are right now as a Commonwealth is wildly out of step with our values. We're losing more people to gun violence every year than die in car accidents. And when you think about the number of people who have firearms versus the number of us who drive, then it's mad. And so there's clearly a need for rebalancing. And we can rebalance within the context of the Second Amendment as defined by the Heller decision, right? So we've accepted that there's an individual right to firearms can see things that work. Universal background checks work. Extreme risk protective orders work. Safe storage laws work. These are things that allow for folks to own firearms, but to do so safely. And so I think that's actually the direction that the General Assembly intends to go. It's setting a number of laws in place that are going to ensure that folks can own firearms, but that we do so in a way that doesn't impact on the security of the rest of the community. And so I think there's a tremendous amount of progress we're going to make there. The governor had 8 bills that were going to go before the special session. Those 8 bills are being looked at right now. I would assume that every single one of them in decent form gets to the General Assembly. And I think there are things that we haven't dealt with that need to be dealt with, like reciprocal concealed carry. So like open carry, you know, right now there's no requirement in Virginia that if you want to carry a firearm, that you have any training on that firearm. You wouldn't allow a weapon out of the arms room in the military to a soldier unless they had training on that firearm. We're not going to, I would like for us not to be in a position where folks are carrying firearms in our community and don't know how to use them safely or don't know the laws around using them. So I think there's a lot of room for change even beyond the 8. But I think as we pass laws and people continue to be able to own the firearms responsibly, some of this divisive rhetoric is going to start. Did I answer it?
Yes, thank you very much. Okay.
There's a lot of pent-up demand, right, for everything ranging from reasonable gun legislation to combating climate change to removing laws that impinge on the equality and dignity of every human being in our commonwealth. It remains, for instance, legal to discriminate against somebody in housing or employment because they're gay. So there's a huge amount of that demand. And what I'm looking forward to in dialogue over the next few weeks is figuring out where does the 40th district lead versus where we participate simply by voting. So I don't know the answer in terms of like what's the bill that I'm going to take over the finish line. Where I am going to, what I'm going to think about it is where are there things that I'm concerned won't get over the finish line unless I help take leadership.
I guess I was referring to a gun safety bill.
Oh, and a gun safety bill. Yeah. I will definitely, I'm looking forward to John Bell, I think, well, are we in John's 7th district?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
We are. Sorry. So John has been leading the charge in the House of Delegates on the concealed carry issues. Love to help him on that now that he'll be on the Senate side of the House. So I think there's one where there isn't a lot of, there aren't a lot of other folks already doing the thinking, and so I think there's some space to work there. But to be honest, I'm not as concerned about where I'm the chief co-patron versus where I'm just a vote that gets over the finish line. As long as we get the full suite of common sense reforms we need, I'm not too worried about who gets credit for it. At the end of the day, if we get better laws, it's fine.
I would just urge you to put the ERA in there because we would really, really like to be the state that puts us over the edge.
It's going to happen. Joint Resolution 1.
I would be so proud of Virginia.
It's going to happen. Joint Resolution 1 is the Equal Rights Amendment. It is going to happen this year. Like, it's not.
Jennifer
Foy is. Jennifer Carol Foy is there. It's a done deal.
Yay.
Sorry.
I'm David Manning. I live just like a mile in the Sarasota district. So, and one thing in regards to firearms, especially living out here in the rural area, there are conflicting local county ordinances with the state laws as to the distance you can fire, within a house. I know that's one of the things you campaigned on. I don't particularly enjoy gardening under gunfire, to be honest. I've been in my backyard and hearing, three round bursts from either an AK or an AR-15, and it's rather disconcerting. Is one of the things the legislature is looking to address is to clarify, you know, set the, you know, fix the bit where, you know, if this law is in conflict with this other law, so that we can, you know, get people out on the range where, you know, in a very safe fashion, you know, rather than these backyard things people have set up.
Yeah, I know that my recommendation is that David Reed, Delegate Reed was working on this, and I think maybe Senator Boyce, but I'll have to go back and check. It's certainly worth, I don't know enough about the specific issue to be like, I know probably that we have the issue, especially in Mountain County, where it's around the land, you know, the folks' homes and stuff like that. So broadly, I'm aware that there's an issue, but I actually don't.
I've been very fortunate to not have any of those rounds land on my property, but we both know those don't stop at property lines or district lines or whatever, they just keep going.
Yeah, when you're setting up a fire pit, you're thinking about things like backstop and offset and all those things. And I don't know enough about what the regulatory structure is in Virginia to other than saying, like, you shouldn't be in your home having to worry about that. Right? That's common sense. So we should address that.
I have a question from a Facebook Live listener. Dan, how are you going to hold people accountable to be inclusive to those with disabilities?
That's a great question. Thanks. And who asked that?
One of our listeners.
Okay. Well, thank you for asking that. I was just yesterday at the, 2 days ago, this week, I was at the ARC. They're all running together. I was at the ARC, which is a great organization, which was really focused on disability advocacy in Virginia. We should start from a premise that we should be a commonwealth which offers every single citizen the opportunity to live their life to the fullest. I think that's the starting basis of it. Therefore, that those with disabilities, we need to do two things. One is help with everything from healthcare costs to education, to making sure that those with disabilities can realize their full potential. And at the same time, we need to recognize the vast enrichment we get by looking at those with disabilities as people who can actually enrich and enable our ability to do things as a society. And so realize the enablement and ability side of disability as well, that those who provide unique perspectives, whether it's from their unique and challenging circumstances or the way in which they view the world, actually enhance us to it. So too often I hear us asking, how do we accommodate disabilities? And I like to think about how are we empowered by those who face challenges and diversity and overcome them as well. So I think those are the two parts of the point. I mean, there are a huge number of, and I think we're going to hear a little bit more too today, but there are a huge number of challenges facing communities with disabilities, whether it's funding to make sure that we have an IEP at the school level, that we're actually executing what it says in that IEP, all the way towards Medicaid waiver wait list, which is a real challenge for those with severe disabilities, many of whom have waited years to have access to affordable healthcare and other services, to the difficulty we're getting right now for those with very severe disabilities in getting things like home healthcare, because we have underpaid many of the providers, and maybe $9, $10 an hour. There's 2.5% unemployment for lots of other things you can do. If we're not paying people well, they're not going to come and help. So the vast array of places that we should be focused on, and I'm really looking forward to a dialogue with the disability community on how we as a commonwealth can become a leader on these issues and make sure that every person here has the ability to live in dignity.
I'm sorry, I'm going to double dipping here. But I'm a participating member in a group called the Citizens Climate Change Lobby.
Mm-hmm.
And the primary focus of that group is to get federal legislation passed to enact a carbon tax, which is worthy, is worthwhile. I'm a scientist who's been following this issue for 40 years, and I can assure you that the good intentions of this group will not solve this problem. That it is baked in that it's going to get worse. I'm sorry to have to say this in a public forum, but it will get worse, and we need to embrace the fact fact that this is not simply a concern, but it's a crisis, and that we as a state have things we can do. They talk about resiliency, they talk about what it means basically is planning for the disasters that we know are going to happen. Coastal flooding, forest fires, droughts, all these things are coming. And it's not like, well, maybe we'll dodge a bullet. They will be here. And the state needs to, as every other state does, needs to start planning, because the federal government will not do this, for protecting our citizens. There need to be plans in place, not just, well, if something bad happens, we'll get some money and help the people. We need to have defined plans in place. People are going to be moving, there's going to be immigration issues. All these things relate to the fact that we have screwed up the climate. And I just urge you and your fellow delegates to take this very, very seriously, because we have run out of time. Thank you.
I'll just comment that we see what's happening in California.
Yeah.
So we know, we're aware of what can happen to us down the road.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, to your point, resiliency is going to be a key. We are going to face impacts of, like, I think what you're saying is, look, we're going to face impacts of climate change, regardless of where we get in terms of reducing our CO2 and methane and other greenhouse gas emissions. And so we need to no longer ignore that that's going to be a key one. I agree with you. And I think there is a component in which Virginia has too far been at the back of the pack,
yes,
for addressing climate change, and we need to do that. So I would like to us to go take the incoming and very significant impacts of climate change on our Commonwealth seriously, and that goes from dealing with Superfund sites. I know there's a new report that said Superfund sites in Virginia are going to be impacted by climate change, all the way to the way in which sea level rise uniquely impacts Virginia because of the way our coastal shelf goes off into the Atlantic. So there's that side of it, but it's also time for us to become a significant leader by driving our renewable portfolio standards much higher than they are today, by making sure we fully costed the impact of emissions into our pricing of energy, and by providing a new infrastructure that ensures that we are the leader on green jobs, that we are a leader in diversifying our energy resources, that we're really taking a new role. I'm looking forward to pushing and working with my colleagues in the General Assembly to get us there.
Out here in the Prince William area, we've run into a lot of issues with environment, with the trash companies.
Mm-hmm.
They constantly moving the day that we have our trash, but the biggest problem is we recycle. We're supposed to recycle, we try to recycle as diligently as we can. Because they have a shortage of people, a good half of the time that they pick up our trash, they throw the recyclables in with the trash after we've already separated it. It's like, why are we doing this? If nobody's gonna hold their feet to the fire. They get fined when they get caught, but it's like $100 each time. And it's like, they could care, you know. We have American Disposal, and they're terrible on this.
Yes, they are. I can confirm that.
So I know it's a local thing, but they're a big company in this area, and they're not the only one.
America's my home provider, too.
Yeah.
I was not aware of that, so I appreciate you.
Let's follow up
on that, because if we can, that should not be happening, right?
Right.
So. I know.
I mentioned this to Danica, and I think that's how that Prince William Times story came out. August or September, but
it hasn't improved.
But like we are a slight change of tax. This is the world, what they call the world crescent out here. I'm not sure if you're aware. The people out here fought a power line development, and finally they get a compromise. Because there's an Amazon data center that was built in the woods right across from Walmart, and after a long, lengthy fight, they compromised on running the power lines down 66 rather than cross country across here. Where do you stand
not sure where
where it is. Yeah, so I think it's worth starting with acknowledging like the two competing pieces of it, right?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you where I land right now, but I think it's like there is massive pressure on house pricing, affordable housing in Northern Virginia, period, right? It is very difficult to afford. Like you're in it since starting to impact our availability of jobs and work. I mean, there are lots of, so that's one piece of it, and people are, we've seen Loudoun County, we've seen it developed to the west. And Prince William County traditionally hasn't had access to the revenue base and other things that come with that expansion. On the other hand, we have not demonstrated the ability to grow smartly in Northern Virginia, and when we add housing, very oftentimes we haven't added environmental, we haven't mitigated environmental impacts, we haven't added the infrastructure to carry people to their jobs, and our schools, we end up with our kids in trailers. Unless we can solve those things, an hour and a half, I'm not in a position where I think we need to be developing the rural crescent. And so, which is not to say, is there a world in which I would ever think it's possible that you would, I don't know. But right now, I would really want to see that we were able to mitigate those impacts in a significant way and maintain the environmental impacts, the impacts on our schools, the impacts on our infrastructure. And someone has showed me it's better to invest in development of single family housing out here rather than pushing for more multifamily housing closer to transit infrastructure farther in that doesn't keep more and more people, running through Clifton on the road, right? Like there is not a lot of great options to get two jobs from here, as all of you probably live every day, so.
I was gonna say, as for affordable housing, that's an interesting word because affordable to some people are, the developers, we got a $500,000 house. Well, trust me, that's not affordable. I'm also seeing a lot of 55 plus communities, which is great for senior citizens, people are retiring, but they start at $400,000. Who in the heck's going to retire and take a mortgage on a $400,000 house?
Yeah.
I can guarantee it's not me.
It is not sustainable. It's going to impact our ability. We have this incredibly vibrant economy and if we don't address affordable housing, I run a business here. It is difficult to attract young people to the area simply by how difficult it is to afford a home. And then it delays, right? Delays when you can have kids. It delays when you can, because all those things you're having to wait later and later in life to do because of the impact of how much of your income is taken up by housing. So we need to address it. There are no easy fixes, but there are some things I'd like to see us start doing this session to make it easy, for instance, to put a mother-in-law suite into a house, which there's other states that have actually done smart things that have begun to alleviate some of the impacts of the housing crisis.
Yeah, so what comes to mind are those small houses that you can put on the back part of your property for your elderly parents, things like that. That's always a good thing.
It's going to require a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
to get there, and I'm excited to do that.
Don't you need a permit to build a small house on your property, and you are limited to square footage?
Yeah.
I mean, we built a shed on our property, which I don't think a cat and a dog could live in compatibly. And I can't imagine humans living there unless they're just sleeping in there and using the main house.
Yeah.
So I don't think that's going to be solved. The housing problem.
Yeah, there are lots of, the building code is chock full of challenges that
you can't even put electricity into some of these, what do they call them? Excessive or additions.
So you mentioned infrastructure a couple minutes ago in regards to infrastructure for transportation. I know Delegate Rome has talked about trying to find a way to get VRA extended out to Gainesville. Because personally, the closest mass transit for this particular area, aside from Taunton Rail, you either drive down to downtown Manassas, you drive down to Manassas Airport, which can be a good 45-minute drive from right here because of traffic.
An hour.
Or more, yeah. And yeah, the Silver Line's coming, but that's still probably a year away. Is getting VRE extended out to at least Gainesville, is that realistic? Is that something that can happen?
Yeah, it can. That's the bottom line, is it can, yes.
Will
I? Well, if Danica and I have anything to say about it, yes. In the past, the approach that's been taken on many of these studies is like, evaluate the feasibility of bringing the VRE out to Gainesville, or evaluate the feasibility of extending the Orange Line, which would be huge, right? Or the Yellow Line and Blue. I mean, there are a number of lines that we have opportunities to extend. I mean, we're doing massive construction on 66. Why are we not thinking about what you do with the Orange Line in the context of that construction? So in the past, I think the general approach has been anti-mass transit approach that says that, you know, please examine the feasibility of this. I think we need to start taking another tack that says, tell us what it would take to get this done. And tell us what the positive impacts of that and the cost, so that we can start to mitigate the cost and make sure we hit the positive impacts.
Is that right? I remember having a conversation with Delia Broome, and she was telling me the cost of getting VRE extended to Haymarket, which, okay, that didn't seem, you know, even I could, you know, that's too expensive. That's, you know, we're talking a couple billion dollars there. That's now. But Gainesville, I'd like to see it happen. I think it would help mitigate all the traffic on 66, which is, I guess, these private, you mentioned that, you know, the construction on 66, this is all being run by one of those private public consortiums. I can't remember the name of the people who are doing this, but they're just adding one lane and then throwing tolls on there. Is there any, are we going to be able to get more transparency or more regulation on these companies that are just willy-nilly, arbitrarily, you know, obviously it's dynamic toll pricing, but what they're doing, how much money they're making, what they're doing with this money, how much is this going back into the states? Because, I mean, nobody likes ridiculous tolls on 66, but all I see is a company getting richer and the quality of life out here being affected for 4 years, and we don't get any benefit out of it. No, that's,
I mean, I hate the tolls too. I live with them, I run my businesses out by Arlington, so I get to live them already, and I know they're going out. The answer is I need to understand it more. I know that we have, where we have put toll lanes in, like where we have the doors, have seen traffic mitigation. Whether that works with 66, I don't have a good sense yet. But my biggest objection to the tolls right now, beyond like the frustration of having to pay them with everybody else, is when they move the hours, right? So when you change the what you considered off-peak hours, you directly impacted those who previously didn't have to pay tolls, many of them can't afford to do it. And so now there's not a, you know, you're taking away, you know, time for families, you're taking, there's all sorts of negative impacts of that that are, unless we have mass transit, unless we have a VRE, unless we have the arms, like, there is no way to fix that. So that's one of my biggest issues.
One of the things I apologize for the follow-up. Part of this deal with the current 66 project is they're taking away the exemption for hybrid and electric vehicles. Any way to get that back?
That's a really good question. I have a hybrid vehicle, but I was past the grandfathering moment for it, right? So because there's a very limited number. So we should be looking at ways in which we encourage electrification and using hybrid vehicles, and whether that's one of them is definitely worth. That's definitely.
Just saying, I'd like to see that come back.
That's a great point. We gotta look at that. Yeah.
So I have a lot of peers that believe that their vote doesn't matter or doesn't count. How do you plan on like appealing to the younger voters and the new generation to begin to vote?
That's a good question. So we had more people show up in this last election than had showed up in the gubernatorial election. At least in this, not over the whole state, but at least here in this district. And I think the best way to say that your vote counts is by making sure that those of us who just are newly elected go down to Richmond and pass an agenda that actually helps young people and takes into account your voice and the voices of your peers. And so I hope that we're going to do that, and then it's on me, and I hope we're friends like you to help me do that, to communicate to people about exactly what happened and what's different. And so that's my hope, is actually, I think we're in a very difficult moment in our politics. But I think the upside is we've seen just more people get involved than I've ever been involved. I didn't imagine that I was going to be running for office right now at this moment in my life. But that changed, and I look forward to like going down to Richmond and serving and fighting for every member of our community, including young people. And so the best thing we can do is, one, to do the things that I was voted in to do, to aggressively take on gun violence, aggressively deal with healthcare costs, aggressively protect women's autonomy to make their own healthcare decisions without interference from Richmond politicians, to go after and deal with climate change. Those are all things that impact you and your peers. And frankly, the impacts are going to be felt more by you and your peers than some of the older citizens who are here in our room, right? So we really need to get you in. I look forward to all of you being engaged in the process, engaged in communicating with me, and then to actually pass an agenda where you can look and say, actually, let the vote count, right? So I don't have a magic wand to wave, but I think that's a good start.
Okay, I was going to say, one of the biggest scourges of humankind in this district is human trafficking. And I'm wondering, how are you addressing this? I mean, we've had some good legislation in the state, granted by Tim Hugo, but I would like to see more enforcement at the local level.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it is awful. I agree that Tim did do some good work on human trafficking, and so we need to where we've made progress, like we need to maintain and expand on that progress, and where there are gaps, like in local law enforcement, then through a combination of training and mandates and dialogue.
Some people don't even realize that it's rampant in this area.
Here and now we're talking about things like gambling and which tend to go hand in hand with human, and we really need to be thinking about the
drugs.
What are the impacts? What are the crossovers? How do we discourage human trafficking? How do we prevent it from? How do we discourage in the first place? How do we educate?
Education.
Educate folks to keep them out. How do we identify youth in particular that are at risk, and mitigate that in advance? And I think those are all part of the answer. I hope you'll stay engaged with me on it, because it's a moral imperative as a community. We need to be addressing.
It's insidious.
Almost got a two-part question, but part of what really why you appeal to me as a voter, I'm an immigrant, Hispanic American, now American woman, became a citizen 10 years ago. So I've lived in Prince William for 20 years, and I've experienced just about anything that you can experience as far as seeing questioning or like passive aggressive discrimination, just because, in my case, because I have an accent, because it's very unfortunate that for the most part I look very white and European, so I can hide behind that, and that's sad. So I see that in Virginia we still have that rhetoric of, that message of like Hispanics specifically, they come here to take jobs and they are the enemy and the illegal immigration and blah, blah, blah. What plan is out there to continue changing that? Because I think we have a bubble in Northern Virginia and it's spilling into Prince William now. I'm so glad that my vote really counted. But what's next? What do we do next to change? And then the second part is like, as far as equal opportunities for women and specifically also for the Hispanic community, because it seems like we're boxed into your house cleaner or a gardener or something like that. But I think there's so much, other states are way ahead of us, I think, in that sense. So
I'm sorry you've experienced those things, and I'm glad to have you as a fellow American. As you know, my dad's an immigrant too. And I think the first step is training. transforming the dialogue of immigration and what immigrants have brought to our country. And to be honest, this is like going back to our roots. I was listening to, I had NPR on one day, and there was just an old radio show. I just happened, they were playing it. It was talking about this idea of being a nation of immigrants. And like really, so it was FDR was talking, friend of mine, Roosevelt, was talking about the importance and how much we're a nation of immigrants and all that. And just thought, where do we lose that along the way? And how do we go back to that where our diversity and what immigrants have brought to us as a whole is recognized as a strength? And certainly Northern Virginia is a great example of this. The vibrancy of here is based on the fact that we just have such a diversity of people here. It's worth celebrating. And I really want to spend a lot of time thinking about this idea of community and how we all together can elevate all of our voices and recognize just the power that we bring with diverse perspectives, diverse backgrounds, to making this community really strong and really have a voice down in Richmond and a voice nationally. Really do think we can be an exemplar. And I think one is this idea of community, but to your second point, it is identifying where there are structural or legal or regulatory barriers, or just societal barriers, and we're not talking about enough. They're pigeonholing people into particular places and thinking through how do we, you know, is the law that we have to change? Is it talking about it, we need to do more? What are the things that we need to do in order to help, you know, eliminate the wage gap for Latinx women is unconscionable. And I mean, for women as a whole, but particularly for Latinx women. And we need to address that. First we need to start by acknowledging it, and then from acknowledging it, removing the barriers that get in the way of folks realizing their full potential. Something I'm looking forward to working together to do that too. I think it is the thing. Figuring out how we build a community voice, I think, is one of the most important things we can do.
I just want to talk about education. Our kids have many concerns, but one of the first and early concerns they have is if they are not able to access the school curriculum because of a reading disability. We actually represent a group called Decoding Dyslexia, and we're trying to push a little bit more forward so that we're helping parents find information quicker, also for letters to know a little bit more, mm-hmm. and also some teachers. There's a lot of things that we move forward, but there's still a lot of work to be done so far as identification and also letting parents know that their children are actually struggling. Maybe there's a lot of parents who actually don't know that their children are struggling, and the mapping is the window of opportunity to actually effectively help them and be their champions. So I just wanted to know, what might get to be done with, even with the funds we currently have, how can we redirect them? Sometimes I think that we have to do special education, just have to be a little bit more targeted on finding the kids really what problems they have so that they don't get bigger and bigger and self-esteem issues start to happen.
Are there initiatives that you've seen that are in the works that you're that the community around dyslexia in particular is thinking about that, like, hey, we need to see more of it? We've seen this work really well. I'm curious just as what you've seen or what you think, like, hey, this is how do we provide opportunities to access the curriculum for way to folks with dyslexia.
Right. Well, first is just more being able to identify them. And basically when a parent does come to you and says, I think my child has a reading problem, that is addressed quickly, and also interventions are put into place notifying parents that their child actually is in a tutored instruction program, mm-hmm. and then if it is being pulled out, if they know about that as well. Notification, parental notification is very important to us. Also, screeners, we've been pushing for that. We've been just pushing for one particular called the RAM, and it keeps getting longer.
Sorry,
the RAM, okay.
RAM,
traumatized memory.
greatly overlooked as being developmental. It's not an issue that they'll find grow it. So by the time it is actually identified, they are older with many poor habits in reading. So we need a better screener, early intervention, and a proper intervention method. There seems to be a lot of disconnect in that. The research is out there. We're really looking for some assistance in legislation to identify a better screener and to really get the teachers educated better to provide better intervention for our kids so that we don't have our middle schoolers and our high schoolers categorize it as an emotionally disabled student because of the anxiety and depression that can accompany that learning disability. So they can't read. They come into school and they can't read like their peers. These children know this at a very young age. When you start seeing other things and behavioral issues, and then it's misidentified as being something else, and really, this child can't read. If that child is identified in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade, ideally, and intervention started, you wouldn't have this big of an issue from this emotional disability that progress, not to mention the school to prison pipeline. They can't read, they can't function, they can't access the curriculum, they turn to other things to keep themselves occupied. So that's really the mission with becoming dyslexia, and that's, we're hoping for your assistance with supporting our legislations or ideas that we want to put forth. That is in the works, so we're hoping that you will support us in that.
I'm really looking forward to working together, and I think, and to your point about funding, please strike me without knowing specific detail, granular components of legislation, that if we can identify children early and stop them later from acting out in ways that are very resource intensive or create a school to prison, facilitating and enabling that school to prison pipeline, that actually the net cost of it is much reduced.
I just want to say hello. Happy evenings. And also, I actually went to elementary school at Mountain View right there.
Uh-huh.
So I experienced the issues that are around dyslexia because I'm dyslexic myself.
Mm-hmm.
And due to the fact that I had a very supportive mother as she's sitting next to me, advocating still, even though all of her kids are out of the elementary school system, high school system here. But I just want to say the reason why I'm fortunate enough to be in this circumstance is because I had that support system built into my family and we had the financial means to do all the things that needed to be done for me. But there's so many kids that I see that are my peers who did not have that and they are currently not graduated. They do other things because they never had that self-esteem to progress further in their education. And I just wanted to say that as a tidbit because I saw it, it's there, and it is a really big issue that I'm very passionate about, and I hope you do look more into all of the things that I know Tim Hugo did for dyslexia and decoding dyslexia to continue the progress, because I know we've made a lot of progress in the past 3 years, 4 years with so I just really want to see that progress forward with all that, and I hope my peers who are younger, like I am, and you, continue to advocate too for all that, so seeing those voices out.
Like my experience was, I was diagnosed when I was in first grade. I couldn't think until I was in fourth grade. I'm currently now at Virginia Tech, and one thing that has been a big problem for me is, and luckily my family is fortunate enough to have the money, is to pay for testing. It's not that you're paying once, it's that I have to pay testing three times, and if I want to pursue graduate school,
yeah,
I would get testing in fourth grade.
Yeah.
Each testing is around $3,000. And so that can add up to anywhere from $9,000 to $12,000, where I'm very fortunate and always been thankful for that. But the other people that can do it, that's not right. And that schools should already change this, but they don't do testing that will find dyslexia, and then they'll be out for type testing that will find it, but it has to pay for the level of the parent. And this is creating a bigger wage gap later on because the people that can't pay for it later when they're a kid are going to be the same problem when they're.
Does the testing show them something? I mean, is it just redundant testing?
Yeah.
Redundant testing. I'm dyslexic in first grade. I was dyslexic in.
It's like testing someone in a wheelchair to be. It's like an invisible dis- requiring someone to be tested every 5 years for not being able to walk when it's like, yeah, let me try and get up, I'll fall over. It's
unfortunately, this is not the only, even invisible disabilities applies. I had my business partner lost his leg in Afghanistan, and randomly has to, every few years, has to prove that he's still missing his leg.
And it's good. So. I was on a starfish, I cannot regrow.
It is a real thing, yes, real. Sarah, did you have something from online?
No.
If I could
piggyback on that, I'm certainly supportive tremendously. The hiring specialists on the front lines of an early intervention. Please, as a delegate, support universal pre-K across the whole state. Right now, counties have to provide matching funds, as you may be aware. A lot of counties don't have those matching funds to get to all those kids. If we had universal pre-K with these early identifiers, you know, I've been here, I've worked with these kids, and I know if I can get them early on in first grade, you know, I can really help them. But we need to go further back. We need to be sure they're ready for kindergarten. We need to, if you will please work for universal pre-K, I would so appreciate it. And don't make the counties do matching funds. Because, you know, think, well, we can't. Chris William, our problem is maybe we could come up with the funds, but we don't have the space to, because our schools are so overcrowded and the need is a lot of need areas. But we've got Bull Run Mountain here. I learned it gratefully. There are a lot of kids up on Bull Run Mountain that could have, you know, used that extra early intervention in pre-K. And there were no programs, there still are no programs in the western end of the county. They're all in the eastern end where they're greatly needed. So please work for universal pre-K.
What we're hearing here is something I talked about in the beginning, which is like when we empower people and find a way to, right, what you're talking about, like just graduated here at Virginia Tech right now. When we look at disability as an opportunity for us as a society to make sure that people realize their full potential, then we are all empowered by it. We are all empowered by that. And so I think it's just so critical. So whether I'm gonna have to talk to Delegatorian, and I don't know where, like, he's the chairman of appropriations, and like I don't know what the funding situation is or what's the scope of the possible, but I do think we ought to act boldly. In the next two sessions. I mean, I think we've mandated to do that, and it's time to look at everything from universal pre-K to more effective screening. So,
there was in some areas where I have lived, pre-K was required. I mean, the public school provided pre-K, and you had to have pre-K before you could go into kindergarten. And it's so south that, excuse me, the expense for the home, for the parents. I don't know what the situation is here. My children are all past kindergarten.
Both child care and pre-K? Or
pre-K. Public schools provided pre-K. And you were required to attend pre-K before you could be admitted to the public school system starting at kindergarten.
I think there's tremendous power in pre-K, there's tremendous power in child care in terms of
because I remember when that was first instituted in the areas where the people said, oh, no. But after a while, everyone loved it.
And just, you know, we do have full day kindergarten, which we have to ensure here in Prince William County.
Yes.
And that's sometimes up for being taken away from us.
And for me, this is an issue that way too. I mean, the people that suffer when you don't have access to them, the people most likely to suffer when you don't have access to pre-K or child care services are women. It takes women out of the workforce and contributes to the pay gap, which I knew came up earlier. I mean, there's all sorts of, as a society, like this is where we need to be.
We have like a few more minutes if anybody has a last minute question, and I'll give you some time to like think about it because I know y'all had a lot of time to ask Dan what you want to know. But I also want to like just mention that Noah is sitting in the back helping out with our Facebook Live. He will be Dan's chief of staff, an incredible human being, and I think I would love, and Dan would love, to continue this conversation, and the best way to do that would be through Noah, for sure. We'll have like a few more questions if you have, but if you don't, Dan, you want to like give us some a few things.
So one, if you ever need something, I can give you my number now. And you can look back. So it's so it's 571.
Do you want to take it?
People try me. I'll get a little bit of voicemail if I don't pick it up. I do work. I will get back to you. So 571-762-4583. And then my email is dan@danhelmer.com.
One more time, 571.
571-762-4583. And email is dan@danhelmer.com. So, and Noah is a great resource who keeps me on track and helps. You know, what I find is, you know, everybody, there are always, one of the best things about running for office and now being in this position is that the number of conversations we've had with people is often find that folks who think they're alone, like they're not. Somebody else's, it's not the same as the thing we've been through. It's something similar, or there's parallels, and so it's oftentimes we've heard some version of it before and been in the process of looking at resources and connections and things like that. So please always do feel free to reach out. Very excited to you know have this dialogue and this conversation with you. I hope it's not the last time that you'll come and speak to me on these issues and ask questions. I hope to take advantage of having my email and my phone number and reach out. And, I view this as a team effort. I'm a representative of this district, which is really hard to do if I don't know what you're thinking and where you'd like us to go. So I would like to make a statement.
If I could just address the young person at the front. I have worked for different elections at different times, and sometimes I feel that my vote has not counted. I began a group called Empowering Voting Women a year ago, and we began coordinating with other groups in the area. And I have to say that this time, I felt that our efforts and my vote did count, and that when I come to a meeting such as this, I am able to express what I think needs to be done for the future, and we've been able to elect a person such as Dan who will represent us. So it's not always going to work in your favor, but it can. And as long as you have that faith and goal in mind, you may feel like I do someday, which is very pleased. Okay. Thank you. You're welcome.
Well, thank you all for being here today, and I'll stick around and take your individual questions, and really appreciate it.
I would encourage you to work with Pete Hammer. He started being so interested. He's very reasonable.
I'm looking forward to it. Pete and I, it is true, so we have time on the calendar. I guess we do. So I'm looking forward to sit down and working together.
The very reasonable.
he listens to those areas. I don't particularly agree with him on a lot of things, but he sits and listens, and he has done good for this area.
I'm encouraged to work with him and every single member of local government to figure out how we